thank you all for coming. It's a funny day. I'm really happy to have Hernán Díaz Alonso here at Ohio State today. So yesterday I was writing the intro that I was going to give for today, and I had already seen a little bit of chatter, but I wasn't following it all that closely. And I wrote this introduction. You know, Hernán and I have known each other a long time, and I was looking forward to, you know, kind of giving that introduction. And then I finished it, and my inbox was filled with stuff about SCI-Arc. So I know that at least some of you are aware that there is a conversation unfolding at SCI-Arc right now that has to do with labor practices in the field, favoritism by faculty members. A lot of accusations have been flying around. I think the smoke has not yet cleared. I think it's too soon to make any judgments. I'm not going to make any. I will say, and I know some of my juniors are here today, we had a really great conversation this morning in my theory course about labor practices in the field. And I want to just thank all you guys for participating. I think it was really enlightening. And I know that a lot of you are curious as to how we might handle the topic, and I will leave that to Hernán to address. But before we get to Hernán, I just wanted to provide a little bit of background. So all of you know, I think, that I taught at SCI-Arc for a while. It's a program that is very dear to my heart. There are many of my friends and colleagues for a long time are involved in the current imbroglio. And I don't have all the facts, so I'm not prepared to make a statement beyond saying that I do not condone interns working for free or favoritism when it comes to scholarships, et cetera, et cetera. And I would hope that everyone who is following this conversation would approach it with some patience and keep in mind that there's some really serious accusations being thrown around, the consequences of which are equally serious. We shouldn't take it lightly. And certain decisions probably are best made not via meme. So I think that this is a conversation that's going to take a little while to sort out, and I know it's one that people are following, and I'll be following it as well. But I just want to make a case for cool heads. And I know I've known Hernán a long time, and I know his head is very cool. So I trust his leadership in this conversation, and that's all I'm going to say about it. But I do want to talk a little bit about the way SCI-Arc has unfolded and just give you guys a little bit of background. The school is turning 50 this year. It was started in 1972 by Ray Cappy. The history of the school has been written. I wrote a version of it. There are other versions out there. But when Ray started the school alongside his wife Shelley and a small handful of other students, it really was born in a context of 60s idealism. This is a school that started in the wake of May 68 and all of the kind of cultural clamor that that date connotes. And it was at that time that the school really adopted the sense of dogged individualism that really kind of characterized it for a long time. Now, Ray came in. Ray was a California modernist, and he made some interesting hires when he first came in. People like Tom Main and Eric Moss and Michael Rotundi and Coy Howard and Robert Mangurian. Ray was the director of the school for 15 years. In 1997, he left his post and Michael Rotundi took over. And when Michael took over, working with people like Robert Mangurian and Coy Howard in particular, those interesting hires that Ray made took over the school, and they radically changed it. Out goes the kind of scientific-based research that was one part of the place. Out goes the kind of legacy of case study, and in comes that kind of particular brand of LA hyper-wrought, handmade work that became synonymous with SCI-Arc. This was not something that Ray planned. This was not something Ray was particularly happy about. But this was what SCI-Arc was built to do. It was built to change. Michael remained the director for 10 years. In 1997, Neil Denari took over. And working with Michael Speaks, who was the graduate chair for a while, Neil and Michael changed the school pretty drastically again. They moved its focus from Southern California to a kind of international audience. They moved the school from Santa Monica to downtown Los Angeles. And they made some interesting hires that were not really like Michael and Neil. And some of those hires were, Hernán Díaz Alonso was one of them, Marcelo Spina, Tom Wiscombe, Peter Testa. So a group of people come in. In 2002, Eric Moss takes over as the director of the school. He has never gotten enough credit for the work he did to put the place on a solid financial footing, to purchase the building, to finally make the place run stably. He did a lot of other things too, and one of the things he did was allowed that generation of interesting hires that Neil made, he made a few more, Eric did, to take over the school and radically change it. And at that moment, you know, SCI-Arc had kind of turned itself into a tool belt school. Everybody had tool belts and power tools, and they made stuff. They welded. By the time Eric's tenure as director was into its maturity, the school had completely transformed into the kind of digital hothouse that we began to see as synonymous with SCI-Arc today. So that's yet another change, yet another radical departure, and one that Eric was not necessarily the guy you would imagine to do it. So SCI-Arc again kind of radically changes. So in 2015, Hernán is named the fifth director of SCI-Arc. And under Hernán's direction, I was there, I was lucky enough to be there for a couple of years while he was director and for several years before that, the school changed again. Its identity changed. Its global presence changed. SCI-Arc became a kind of juggernaut of international significance. And Hernán had a hell of a lot to do with that. Hernán also made some interesting hires. And he made some interesting hires that are not particularly like him. They aren't the kind of people you would expect. They're not little mini Hernans. And there are plenty of little mini Hernans out there in the world. But he hired people like Mira Henry and Natu Fall and Graham Harmon and William Virgil and Gordon Kipping and Jana Niemark. And as this conversation is unfolding at the school, it may well be that we're at a moment where the school is poised to make another one of these drastic, radical changes that you wouldn't predict from the director that under whose watch those changes are taking place. So I've known Hernán a long time. I know how seriously he takes this. I know how meticulous he is in making sure that this situation is investigated properly, that the facts are, that the facts come to light, and that everyone involved gets a fair shake. Again, I think that's gonna take time, but that's just all I have to say about it. You know, the SCI-Arc is a place that changes. It's a place that changes again and again, and I think it's probably about to change again. And I think that those changes have been good. They've often been unpredictable, but they do happen. So I just wanted to kind of lay out that history and how hopefully it helps to kind of situate the conversations that are taking place right now. And so I know I've been talking for a little while. Maybe I'll just stop there. Hernán, I'll give you the introduction that I was going to give before. But I will just say, I know, fuck it, I'll just do the whole thing. So here's what I was going to say, which is really about Hernán the architect and Hernán that guy. I'm so happy to welcome here to Ohio State tonight. And the standard cliche that we often hear would tell you that Hernán needs no introduction. At some level, as with most cliches, There's some truth to it. He doesn't really need much introduction. He's been famous or infamous in advanced architectural circles from nearly the moment he entered the field, around the turn of the millennium, after his education in Rosario, Argentina, and in the Papal Studios of Colombia. Since then, his name has been synonymous with the most advanced forms of architectural speculation in our discipline. So have you ever been interested in ecstatic formal complexity, or digital animation, or parasites, or mirror chrome, or contemporary ornament, or the glitch, or monstrosity, or dogs, or flowers, or butchery? Well, Hernán got there first. And when he got there, he established the terms of those conversations. He kind of set the table for how the field would take up those problems. And in most cases, he moved on to more interesting territory way before all those copycats got wind of what he was up to. Now, have you ever been interested in neo-pomo pastel? Or clever quotations or minimalism? If so, you got the wrong guy, that's not him. But it turns out introducing Hernán introduces a different problem. And this is the problem of which Hernán to introduce. Jeff and I were talking about this the other day. And the problem is, do we introduce Hernán the architect? Or Hernán the teacher? Hernán the administrator? Hernán the golfer? He's a world-class talent in each of these arenas. Maybe not yet with golf, but I know he's working on it. But Hernán is someone that has this incredible ability to take something that you thought couldn't get any better and make it even better, make it better than you ever thought possible. That's what he's been doing at SCI-Arc now for more than 20 years, first with the X Lab, then with graduate thesis, then with the graduate program, and then with the school as a whole. In each case, he took something that seemed to have hit its peak, and he figured out how to establish a new, steeply upward trajectory, usually against considerable odds. So under Hernán's guidance, that distinctive, handmade, aggressively wrought West Coast formalism that made SCI-Arc famous and seemed, by the late 1990s, to have run its course, seamlessly transformed into the digitally crafted, internationally focused, and wildly experimental work we associate with Hernán today. Under his guidance, SCI-Arc thesis, which had established itself as a benchmark for hyper-individualized explorations that productively blurred the boundaries between architecture and studio art, was transformed into the eye-popping multimedia frenzy that has become the model that every school, secretly or not so secretly, wishes it could match. And under Hernán's guidance, the scrappy, by the seat of your pants, always on the edge of insolvency little school that Eric Moss finally placed on a firm financial footing, has become the formidable institutional juggernaut that we all know, and if you're an administrator, envy today. Now, I understand this all sounds hyperbolic, and there's a part of me that can't stand to lavish this kind of praise on somebody that I spent the better part of a decade arguing with. But even so, I think these observations will hold up to scrutiny, and they will because Hernán, and this is the Hernán that I really want to introduce, really is, as the title of his latest monograph implies, a visionary. It's probably going to take me a little time to live this down with him, but he really does see possibilities that nobody else sees. And even more importantly, he sees them through to realization. It was a real privilege and a hell of a lot of fun to work alongside this guy for as long as I did, almost 10 years. And it's always a thrill to see the latest thing he's up to. So let's get to it. Before we get to it, I just want to say this conversation is messy and it's ugly and it's going to take a while to resolve. And I know it's in good hands with Hernán leading it. So with that, please help me welcome the visionary architect, teacher, administrator, and golfer, Hernán Díaz Alonso.
Thank you for that, I guess. I think you have a career in law after this, if you choose in law, I think. I really don't know how I can add anything to what Todd said, that they will match his ability to articulate his words. I miss his evilness in the school. Tom always have like a beautiful evilness eye for things. I just wanna be also very open and transparent about all the situations. So The idea of this lecture was to talk about my work, but I'm totally happy we want to talk about something else. If people feel like we need to discuss the thing that are floating in the ether, for good and for bad, this is who I am, this is my face, this is my name. I put my name and I put my persona behind everything I do, with my virtues and my shortcomings as an art, as a designer, as a teacher, as an administrator. There is a lot of noise floating there, I mean, like many other places, but we always seem to be at the center of the storm on any given turn, and I think that's part of the tradition of the school. And usually with things like this happen, the attitude is, let's put it in the open, let's rip on it. We just conducted a town hall on Monday with all the students, and everybody was welcome to flash it out. Of course, that takes multiple dimensions in social media, and that is way beyond our control. So I'm happy to talk about that if that's what everybody prefers. I'm happy to talk about my work if that's what everybody wants to see. And we can talk about something else in the Q&A. I'm totally game for everything. As I said, there are many things, there are process and legal protocols and things that are moving in place that probably I cannot discuss. But again, information today, like somebody said, I think, that what the truth is putting their pants on, the lie goes around the world. So I'm not saying that everything is unfunded and so on. Like everything else, I think our professions, our institution are far from perfect. I think it's a very imperfect profession. And I think the schools and the people that run the schools and teach in the school, we are part of those problems. And we need to be much more aggressive in those changes, and we need to be fully aware of the evolution of times. But also we need to understand that progress happens also because when bad things happen, and those crises become opportunities. So I vow to do what it needs to be done in our school. It's my responsibility. Whatever happens in that place, I am the ultimate responsible for it. So whatever is good or bad, I'll take full responsibility, and I'll do everything I can to correct what needs to be correct. But at the same time, we need to understand that the profession out there, outside the walls in this school and others, it has its own issues. It has a long heritage of very bad things, sometimes out of need, sometimes out of greed, sometimes out of just evilness, sometimes out of powerlessness. I'm not making excuses for it, and I think all of you are the force of that change, and all of you make us accountable and make us to react and trying to leave behind the biases and deformations that we may have from the times that we were. Because part of the conversation, we always have to remember that things have a context and things have a history and things keep evolving. And if you remember, 2 years ago, all the schools were very engaged in the conversation of equity and inclusion and Black Lives Matter and the assassination of George Floyd, of course, in the middle of the pandemic. And that was a brutal awake for everybody, and we all have to look in the mirror and be accountable for who we are as individuals and institutions. And change were made. And I think for good and for bad, SCI-Arc has the capacity to make change faster because we are an independent institution. We are not part of a big university. And this is another crisis that it will make other good ideas, good things and corrections to flourish. So we listen to the students. They may not like the speed that the response comes about the requests, concerns, criticisms, but is what we listen to it, and we acknowledge them, and we will try to correct them as much as I can. Again, assuming and accepting the imperfection of it, and the imperfection of all of us, and my own imperfection. So in many ways, I have to say, I'm 53, I'm from Argentina. I feel like a dinosaur in many aspects sometimes in my life. As a designer, I think I represent a breed of an idea of speculation that is probably not the mainstream or what the interests of many students or young practitioners are involved these days. But at the end of the day, you do what you do. So I'm really open to do as we all want to do. So I'm happy to show you some nice images and cartoons of my work, and we can talk more about this after. We can just skip my work. I mean, it's not that difficult. You can Google it and appears there, here and there. So all good. I mean, which it brings another question or conversations about why lectures these days, right? Because what do we have? Usually there's new stuff that it doesn't float up there. But again, before I proceed, I'm a very transparent, very straightforward, honest person to the extent of what I can and cannot say legally. But I'm happy to have a conversation about any concerns that you may have, not only about SCI-Arc, but how that relate to the larger aspect. So we can use whatever time we were having for this lecture to do that, or I can show you some stuff, and then we can have a Q&A about the other stuff. So I don't know. What you gonna do? All right, that probably, it may take us to a way worse Q&A than we were talking about the other one. So I accept that. But again, I'm happy to talk about that after, and I'm happy to talk to you in the hall, that sometimes happen. And as the only thing I will say in the context of what Todd said, I'm old school. I like frontal confrontation. So you can come to me and say the worst. But if you see it to my face, I know who you are, no problem. We are good and we're gonna engage. I hate anonymity. I hate when things get thrown around, and I understand why. I understand why, but all of you, you can always reach me in my email. I can give it to you, and you can, whatever you want to say, you can say it to me, and you can ask whatever you want to ask. Anyway, so let's talk about the work a little bit. So as Todd mentioned, this was the last book, and the only reason I'm showing it there because I want to honor the editors, because this came right at the beginning of the pandemic, so I want to make sure that they know that I still say that there is a book out there. But the book, basically, we focus mostly on the last 10 years. There was a previous book that focused on the other things. One way or another, and again, this may not be shifting paradigms for any of you anymore, but these are my shifting paradigms. These are the things that have been driving my obsessions. I always talk about that. Actually, I wanted the book to be called Obsessions, because I think designers, we are driven by obsessions. And I think the energy, the drive by that. One thing I want to say too is, in the context of this, I always on the side of, believe it or not, of the students, because I believe that angry young people need to be protected. Angry old people, not so much. So I just want to be clear that as I get into being old, I don't want to be an old angry man. I want to be a wise old man that is still trying to figure out how to keep doing things and work with people and trying to understand ideas. Anyway, so the work, everybody knows, I'm very openly a formalist. I never hide it. I'm an architect by training. I happen to be the head of a school of architecture. But I think of myself more as a designer, really, than an architect, because my interests have to do with almost with scales. Like, I'm interested in all sorts of scale, all sorts of things. And the more recent work, it has been pushed, and also embracing to walk away from architecture for many reasons, but also have to do because I just have a curious mind and I have a very distracted mind. So I always need to be working in multiple things at the time. So some of the things you may be more familiar. So I'm not interested so much in to talk about the old work. I just want to use it as a frame of reference from PS1 in 2005 and things that we did and things that you learn. That to have a project that they have almost 1,500 structure pieces, all different, is not a smart idea, and you learn things. And believe me, more than once we try to think, can we do something simpler? And we try and we start, and so along the way, we get deviated. But these also are byproducts of a particular period of time as well, because I think it's interesting because As Todd was saying, I've been around in the game for a while. So this work is already like, I don't know, 17, 18 years old. So at that time, like many others, I was obsessed with single surfaces and how to start to produce disruption and articulations and saturations. We built at the beginning the practice that was mostly about exhibitions in show and kind of hybrids between architecture and art. This was a show that we did in SF MoMA, in which we were, at that time, we were very obsessed with the idea of cells and load cells and multiply. I like to work in families of projects. This is something that is not new. I literally stole from Enric Miralles and Benedetta Taglebue, and before Enric Miralles and Carme Pinoz, that they had this ability to work in multiple things under the similar idea. So it almost like it's a notion of autopsy, which the end of one project becomes the beginning of another one. It's almost like a continuous that they keep mutating. So even in this case, literally, that was first in the SF moment, then he moved to the Art Institute in Chicago and took a different shape. It was called Sangre, which means blood, because we were looking into blood cells. So as Todd mentioned in his beautiful introduction, I believe in the theory of a sponge. I believe architects, we are like a sponge that we absorb everything and then you squeeze and some kind of dirty, ugly thing comes out. But I always been way more fascinated by agencies of contamination than the purity of it. I'm not what some people, somebody like Andrew Sago will call a disciplinarian. I think he considers discipline. I'm not. My interests usually have to do with a lot of, as I said, a distracted mind. I'm interested in banal things. I'm interested in pop things. I'm interested in everyday things that you can elevate through manipulating. Like when we did this exhibition at the MAC in Vienna, the idea was inspired by this horrible movie with Vin Diesel called Pitch Black. But they have this great effect of this monster that it will show in certain moments. So I always thought that was a cool idea. But at the same time, we were obsessed. Can we build imprecision in precisions? I mean, one of the things that fascinates me, the thing that fascinates me the most about computers is not only the funkiness of images or the coolness of the speed of things, but the possibility that you can produce new coherences out of incoherent things. So you can mix a bunch of stuff and it will make sense. So in this case, it was one of the first projects that we worked using particles and liquid things because we wanted to kind of reverse engineer. We manufactured this with Dura Paris in Lexington, Kentucky, and we put it in a box and we ship it there. We learn our lessons for PS1. So in this particular case, the pieces are all the same, the legs are all the same, we just tweak it a little bit to produce the effect of differentiation. But in this case also, we didn't use animation as a form finding, we use animation also as a setting. We wanted the people to be in the exhibition like if they were inside an animation that can be walking around and so on. And again, there's an interesting thing because as I said, I consider myself more a designer than an architect, but the training that you have, an artist, let's say, or industrial designer would never do it this way. They will be much more compact in the reducing elements. Architect, we tend to make it too complicated, adding too many things. I mean, the old joke, right? You ask an architect to design a racehorse and he will give you a camel. But as part of that, again, working in parallel, so when we were doing that show, we also were invited to do a competition for a guest house for an art collector in Paris. And it was the first time that we really started to say, okay, what if we work with multiple cells? Well, what if we don't work only with repetition, but we can create three entities and then they can mutate into something else. And the other thing is we embrace it and embrace it very early. And to me it was a quasi-psychological thing. I was and I remain a huge fan of Enric Miralles, Benedetta Taglebue, and Carme Pinoz in different phases of their work in Barcelona. And I was lucky enough to work with them for a little bit. And so I needed to find a way to get out of that because of the two-dimensionality. So we want to really embrace the animation, the camera as a way to design. So even though, yes, we produce form in one of the shifting paradigms and said that for me, form follows image. And we embrace that idea. And we embrace the notion to use animation not only as a tool for representation, but as a simulation of something that you design with. So this has to do with a long story that at the beginning I really wanted to be a filmmaker and not really an architect. It's a long story, I will not tell it, but I became an architect by accident. Everything has been a collection of accidents in a way. So anyway, out of that thing, we did this for that institute, what we call the Chair Grotesque. Joe Ross invited us to be part of a show, and we wanted to play around a little bit with algorithms at the beginning. So we took the inf chair and we start to like, why do you inject a virus in the famous inf chair? And we did this. I think it's one of the worst things that we ever done, but it got fabricated. And it got, sometimes it's good to pay attention to what you do, because you never know which ones they get to be, which one they will get made or not. So this one was made, we did a version in black, and I think later on through that we made a version painted in gold for some collector. In parallel to that, we worked for a while with Alessi trying to develop a tableware collection. This was the first one that we did that we call it Mutant Manners. That also, we use that family, that genetic. I'm flying through this because I want to get to the more recent work. We use pieces of that to produce this kind of installation for a department store in London. And this is what I think one way or another we are. So I was talking about agents of contamination. I think this is also not an original thought. Actually, I don't believe that much in original thought. I just like to use things that are very straightforward and conventional and see where it takes you. So over the years, there were differences in contamination, like many others in the early 2000s when we were getting into computers and all that. There was this notion of biology, then we had ornament, then we worked with cinematic effect, which is still used somewhere, artificial nature, rituals, butchery. Butchery is still very much of an obsession. And lately I've been very, very obsessed with this notion of rusty sophistication. I think it has to do with evolving or involving, I don't know if that's a word. But as I said, part of these projects, some of the early projects still were driven too much by this idea of cinematic effects and cellular behaviors and the notion to create a species instead of type. But in this project, what it became interesting in this competition for a museum in Spain was that we were one of the first projects that we needed to negotiate with existing things. So the notion of dirtiness, the notion of conventions with the other things and how you start to negotiate them, it became much more interesting. I mean, in that case, we were looking at a lot of prosthetics and stuff like that. But also it triggered a certain kind of a reminder of my early young days as a plan obsessive drawer when I was at school in Argentina, because I learned to draw by hand, ink and a miler. Check it out, it's an historical thing now. But we were designed to work by plan. And I never been good on working through sections. I always thought that the section and space was a byproduct of plan. But note, I also understand that plans today are not anymore X-rays, or they are not, at least for me, they are not anymore organizers. They're MRIs. There's something that a byproduct to understand the three-dimensionality that you're working on. In parallel to that, as I said, we always work in families of projects because it's the way that my brain works, is a structured one. This was the second tableware collection for LSE. None of these things got ever produced, and they were too complicated to fabricate, and many other things that happened to them. Glasses, trays, museum competition based on the same principles. In this one was the first one that we introduced platonic geometry, because I always think the platonic geometry have a certain unfriendly quality. So that was something that I was interested also to start to use generic elements into some of these things. So this was another installation did for the Mac in Los Angeles. It was in the Mac apartment in the garages. So we wanted to do this flower installation. So we figured out to work with people who know how to do funeral arrangements and to do a structure of flowers. The show will be for 3 months in the summer, so it starts to smell very bad, like a cemetery, and eventually fall down. And we have a little of these bubbles with, this is before iPads, so it was some kind of a more simpler thing for animations. And eventually everything collapsed and it started to develop this fungus inside. which it was something, again, we learned also when PS1 and everything fall apart very fast. I mean, probably it was one of the PS1 pavilion that fall apart the faster. I think by the second week it was destroyed. But that's something that, oh, it interests me, the notion of decay, the notion how we can contaminate the purity that tend to happen when you work in the computer. And the other thing with the flower was interesting, it started to give us a way out on the problem of color. I'm horrible with colors. I don't know how to do colors. And I thought it was an interesting idea. So with the ultra excessive ornamental quality we're working, if this became vehicles for nature to grow, it would be an interesting thing because it can change color over time and so on. And so this was the first version for a pavilion for the Thyssen Bornemisza Foundation in Vienna. They wanted to do in Patagonia in Argentina. Didn't happen. Then we have what I call the Roth chairs, the same person that asked us to do the competition for the house. They wanted to have a couple of very strange chairs, so we were interested in a chair that would intimidate you, that you will feel uncomfortable to sit. I know that when I say it out loud, I realize how stupid it sounds and how anti-commercial it is. But it was interesting for us, this idea to figure it out, how the structure can be detached from the screen and the skin, and how it can give you a sense of being unstable. And then we did a bench of that, and there was a bench for the house in France, for this woman in France. But also we did a version for a friend in Argentina that it will have cow hide. I love cows. I love how they shape. I like animals for ideas. I like the mass in disproportion with the legs. I like the notion of animalization of things. But that brings me to, I will say, the concept that in one way or another they are very close now. And what they have to do with the notion, my one of my latest obsessions is the literal, which is something that architects, and especially your formalists, you struggle with. Because we tend to produce abstraction all the time. And I was interested in, can we be literal? Can we use that literal? I mean, this is Francis Mallmann that by now some of you may know by Netflix Chef's Table. But at the time was a very important, interesting chef in Argentina who at some moment he gave up all his traditional French cuisine to start to mix it with ultra primitive. So he had this kind of a high-end, low-end. Bikini was in this one. And the idea was, okay, can we do a project that is really tries to be a cow? Like a project with an identity crisis that they want to be a cow and not really a pavilion. And this is the version from Thyssen in Patagonia. But the other thing which was interesting, if you notice until then, most of the renders were kind of a clinical and clean. So we start to get much more interested in dirtiness or certain kind of what I call digital surreal qualities. Surreal is a term I don't like to use that much, but there was something of that, a little bit of that, and try to, okay, can we get something out of it? Can we, how far we can push? And then this is probably one of the projects that we push the most. I truly apologize for those of you who are vegetarians or vegans. It was not done with any intention of that. This is not real meat or anything like that. But there was an aspiration of that. So we proposed this idea for the pavilion. But also then, actually, there was something that we were working with Jeff at some point that we wanted to figure it out. Can we do a sculpture literally out of meat? And we speculated a little bit, and then I went and bought I don't know how many books on butchery. Again, I'm Argentina. This is part of my culture, part of my identity. And as you get older, you're much more comfortable to bring your own biological, biographical desires into it. So we start to, okay, what if we do it literally about that? We can put it out, we can mill it in the cold weather or whatever. It went nowhere, of course. And also it was inspired by an exhibition that I saw many moons ago, circa 96 in Barcelona, by one of the leaders of the Fura del Bau, which is a spectacular alternative theater group. And he did these exhibitions of human bodies made out of meat. And the exhibition was for the whole summer. So by the end of the summer, four blocks from the museum, you can smell it. And I, I don't know, I gravitate to those things, and it was interesting, and almost the counterintuitive, like what if you take disgusting things or strange things and you try to squeeze some kind of a sophisticated idea out of that, out of the cow period. We worked on this one. This one, it came back to life. Now we are retrying to retool it and see if we can do it. It was this porcelain lamp, it's a small thing that would like little cows, and they wanted to do this porcelain lamp for kids. And now we find a place that maybe we can do it, and so we're trying to do a couple of them for ourselves. We also did a remote control container for a big corporate bank they wanted to have in their conference room. Out of the same principle, out of the same cow family, we also did another attempt with Alessi to work with them, and a coffee mug and a coffee espresso. And then we did a mate version, for those of you who know Argentina, it's something that we drink, it's like a super heavy, aggressive green tea. You know it?
No.
Ah, you like it? Or you're finding funny, whatever it is. Appreciate the laugh. So we did a prototype in metal and so on, which is not a good idea because it's too warm. But anyway, we're trying to figure it out. We did some art. And these are the popcorn series. These are not renders. These are the things that are this big. Again, the literal, we wanted to scan popcorn and put some ornament and just 3D print it. So we did a couple of them. In the meantime, there are also other things, and this was for Infonavit in Mexico. Infonavit is the government agency we deal with social housing for very low income housing, and they wanted to, the person at the time, Carlos Cedillo, the director, wanted to invite a lot of architects to speculate more ambitious ideas that they were commonly dealing with. And the idea, the challenge was to come with a prototype between $10,000 and $15,000 in Mexico. So what we proposed, the idea that we wanted to explore, I mean, we all were given a particular region, a small town nearby, not that far from Mexico City, actually. And the one that we did was a place that they used to do these water tanks in booths. So we thought it was an interesting idea. What if we use 3D water tanks? That is very common in the Mexican culture, that your house during the day became some kind of a shop, a workshop that people work, and then at night they live in it. So we thought there was an interesting idea to maybe take three of these tanks, put these big doors that can open and close during the day, and produce a roof made out of a tent. We reached out to companies with that tents for people who climb big mountains and so on. So the idea was to do something that can be fairly fast, fairly cheap, but also they will have some kind of music to it. We were not selected. Some of my colleagues were selected, and some of them did a fantastic thing. If you want to check it out, Michael Meredith and Hillary Sample did the master plan for it. There are like 50 of these prototypes. The party wasn't going, lost the election, so I think the project died with that. But it was a really interesting initiative at the time. And this, I don't want to talk about it. It's just weird. There are two urns for the ashes of a couple who are still alive, but they wanted to have two urns for when they died and be next to each other. So we better be flat. Anyway. Moron Butchery, this is a competition that we did in partnership with Juan Rincón in Bogotá. In Colombia, and this one was the first one that we took really an aggressive notion of butchery. Well, one of the things that interests me about butchery is the notion of carving and the idea that you can do three-dimensional manipulation of matters and so on. So in Latin America, it's very common, and still people are very interested still in certain traditions of modernism, Latin American version, but everybody likes that. So we thought it would be interesting to play a little bit of a game with that and to create a building. And for the animation is deceiving, but the idea is from outside, the building will look fairly mute and very conventional curtain wall. And then you will walk into this courtyard and will have this carving with this kind of a three-dimensional garden feeling to it. And here is a little bit more clear. In parallel to that, the Barcelona Regional, which is the agency who deals with the project that connects Barcelona with all the other cities that people consider part of Barcelona, but they're autonomous. They ask us to do like a pedestrian pathway to connect Barcelona with San Adrià de Besòs. And this is a tiny creek that dies in the Mediterranean, and also it has like a whole ecological part that is a bird protected reservoir. And we went back to some of the things that we did early on when we were focusing more on lines and geometry, and the idea with the bridge was to work with three modules that we can rotate and manipulate and make it different, and also make it like the bridge will move. It's a pedestrian bridge, and the bridge is not that far. There's a big part that is a platform to observe the birds. And again, you can see flowers, and the idea to grow nature everywhere and to have this kind of a wild thing became part of the narrative of it, and also you see that there is a recurring theme about the fears and chrome, and many people ask me why chrome and shiny. I don't have an answer. I like shiny things. And we indulge ourselves with that, like there's certain thing that we are okay, that we like it, we'll do it. And sometimes, I don't know, maybe you had to trace it back to when you were 4 or 5, or what I talk with my therapist. I'm Argentina, I do therapy. It's part of our genetic code. We all do. Not we all do, but many of us do. And so anyway, the project was that, and you can see, as I said, the bridge part was actually is not that far. The bridge part was probably from that wall to that wall only. The rest was more like a platform, so it allows us to stabilize that, and we work with Klaus Bollinger, which is this fantastic German engineer. And actually, we thought that we were doing something super complex, and he says that structurally it was not that complex. So he helped us to develop these modules that would allow the fact that they make it look like many pieces are different, but actually there are only three, and it was a series of combination. Once again, politics got on the way. The socialist government that was in power, they lost the election. And when the new director of Barcelona Regional came, the project died, and it's okay. But we also took that concept, and working again with Infonavit in Mexico, we developed, they asked us first to come with the idea of two plazas and a bridge that connects to a neighborhood in Jojutla, which is in the skirt of Mexico City. And we told them, what if we combine the three budgets and we do like a very elevated garden bridge that people can cross in different way. It can become also kind of a destination for weddings, quinceañera, mariachi festivals, and all the things that make the wonderful, extraordinary, beautiful Mexican culture. So the idea was to produce that. I mean, there's also this wonderful vegetation. So the concept was to try to create this three-dimensional elevated garden that is a bridge, but also give you the option, because there's a lot of fluidity between the two neighborhoods. I always like the idea that, okay, you have more than one way to cross from one to the other. So the bridge has this little bit of adventure, and maybe you can stop and something else. And this is something that it was inspired actually from when I visited Yokohama in Japan, from at that time FOA, Alejandro Sarapolo and Farshid Mousavi, in which the interior is dark and infrastructural and all that, but the roof is this wood roof, and it's incredibly activated, and it became this extraordinary public space. So we thought that this was a way to work on it, and we were interested in the work with the community and figure it out, metal, wood, and all that, and we were going to process a simplified, again, victim of the local politics. For those of you who are not aware, most of the work in Latin America they have to do with this is usually government. It's not private money, it's government money, it's neighborhood initiatives and so on. So it's always at the mercy of politics, and because every 6 years there is elections. So if you don't get the project at the beginning of the 6 years, it's very unlikely that it will go through it, because even when the same party remains in power, somebody else comes, the authority, and they want to change and do something else. So we couldn't do it. I don't know, it may come back to life at some moment. Again, it was a beautiful project. We met with the neighbors, we talked to them, they were excited about it, and but anyway, nothing happened. Which sometimes I think, like, we're very ecological because most of the things that we do doesn't get built. So we don't add any footprint to the planet. But at the same time, like everybody else, I think this is something that it was not probably at the front of my head when I started working, but it has become more and more part of what we all need to do. I still believe there is basic principles, and I'm not saying by any means that what we do is good design, so that's up to you to judge it. But I really think the first rule for sustainability is we all should try to do good work that doesn't need to be renovated or turned down every 10 years so that people like it for a while and stay there. So number one. Number two, we really need to revisit how we build stuff, because most of the buildings, when they're done, actually they don't do that much damage as the construction process of the 4 or 5 years, which is fairly unregulated. So again, I'm not really a big practitioner of anything, but since we are in this particular time, which there are all these conversations about practice, internships, unpaid, pay, what is fair, and so on, it also has to do what is the work that needs to be done. And I think sometimes we ask, we demand from architects a lot, and it's fair, but also we should demand a lot from the construction companies and the people get involved that are producing the other part, and somehow, anyway, this is a competition for a library in Helsinki. This kind of escape, it was not supposed to be part of today. Another thing that we did for Infonavit at that time was to come with a concept for emergency units when they have earthquake or things like that. So as you can see, I like textiles and fabrics a lot. So the idea that we came was a simple one, to have a concrete piece that will be bathroom and kitchen, and then the rest could be like a tent that you can adapt and change and so on. And again, in this case, it's all repetition. The model is always the same. And again, there were, and because one of the things that you learn in Latin America, say you can expand it, is some of these emergency things, it became like 3, 4, 5 years. So it's not like a tent that comes away. So they were interesting to produce something that have a certain stability. But again, the person in charge at the time, it was really interesting to produce a design that was a little bit beyond the traditional things that get done for that. Again, unfortunately, we didn't get to do it at that time. That gave us to a sideway, one thing that we still under construction in Argentina, in La Picada, which is in the middle of, well, not the middle of nowhere, but it's half hour away from Paraná, which is a city of 300,000 people, is 500 kilometers north of Buenos Aires. I don't even know why I mentioned that. I mean, it doesn't matter. None of you have any idea where this thing is. It's Pampa, okay? It's 12 acres, it's house in it, and so on. And this is something that is the first time I collaborate with my wife, with Florencia Pita. We don't work together, but in this case, we wanted to do this together and see what happens. And it was a lot of compromise between the two of us. And then we divided certain parts that each of us took over. And so it's a very fairly compact house. The house itself, the kitchen, living area, the two bedrooms, and the mezzanine, and the other, I mean, the whole thing is around 1,500 square feet. And then there's a garage and thing that you can put all the countryside elements that you need to have a life in the countryside. This will be built, we know they will be built with local construction techniques, super simple and straightforward. So it was this part of the primitive sophistication. It's an interest of mine, and it's an interest, I think, to understand the Florencia, but also was a pragmatical aspect. This is what can be done in that context. There were no other options, so we tried to figure it out. Can we get some movement? Can we get some things out of this? And we knew that there will be a lot of opportunities in the landscape, so we did the concrete, a little bit of corduroy concrete here and there. The concrete, we know that it will, that's how it looks. It will not be a talado hondo concrete. We knew that, but also we wanted that, we embraced that. So the whole thing is designed for either no details or details that they will be not so well solved, but, and they will be interesting because of that. So they have the kind of a raw quality. So as I said, part of the game is also, it's a house, but one could argue that it's a roof to be outside all the time and to deal with that. And then start to play with ceramics and incompleteness inside some of the part of the bathrooms. This is the landscape is still being in process. There is a whole series of grass and land movement that is coming that they're gonna fit into this, and the columns, instead to have big columns, are tiny columns, not tiny, but small columns, like two legs. And the roof, there's a metal roof, and we find a company who does industrial buildings that they were courageous enough to say, well, we'll give it a shot. And it worked out fairly okay. I mean, the close-ups are okay. But I love it. I mean, I love it. And then the concrete floor, and then we have insertions of ceramic. I always love this idea that houses that you live like they're borrowed, that they have a history. So originally, the original version for the project was to find an old farmhouse and renovate it, and that didn't work. So at the end, when we were asked to work on this, we figured it out, okay, we can create like fake memories that are things that were already there. This is one of the bathroom. This is the shower that is coming in eventually. You can see a little bit of the structure, which is kind of fun, coming together. But the whole house is designed for that, to be outside looking into that. This is a couple of months ago. I don't have any new picture from about. The landscapes are almost finished now. Going back to the other stuff, this was a lamp that we worked for a while, and it had come back to life in the middle of the pandemic, so we're trying to figure it out. Instead of the lamp, we decide, well, we don't design a light bulb, so we can have this melt. Again, banal, simple things that they're next to you. What we melt them, and what happened if you just buy it and put it there. So it's not a lamp, it's a light bulb. We've been doing some landscape art, and again, going back into some of the primitive notions and ideas, and we're doing this this basket weaving explorations, which is, I'm really excited about it. There's another things of urban equipment that we work on, also a whole line of things that need to be fairly simple and durable. This is one of the things that I like the most, is this bench chair for parks, that we wanted to look like a little animal or a little piece of grass, and the idea is maybe to have some hydroponics so grass can grow into the thing. The idea is to make it out of concrete, and that they will grow. I mean, it should be more green than that, but that's a little bit the idea. And so when you put it in a park, you don't know it's part of the park, it's part of the vegetation, or what it is. Another thing that we've been working for a while is the Sharpei chairs collection. So again, I love dogs and I love Sharpeis. I like things that they don't fit, and the Sharpeis, they have way more skin than they need to have. And I thought that was a super interesting idea to develop a series of lounge chairs. What if we can use that? And it started with something more complex, and we try now to simplify it and see, can we make it out of weaving? It's not bamboo, it's mimbre, but I forgot how we say it in English. And we are working with local artisans in Argentina to figure out if we can make them and put in the house that we're doing down there. We did a prototype in metal, but that's not the right way. I think the way is to go with the weaving, and also they have a certain softness. This was another experiment, the chicken chair. So pushing towards the end, a couple of competitions that we did for the national, this was for the National Museum of Writing in Korea. And in our notion, this artificial nature was mentioned earlier, the notion was to almost to hide the building inside this thing. So the buildings are those wood volumes. And then outside, the idea was to create a structure with some kind of photovoltaic panel system, but also to have vegetation growing. So almost, again, a three-dimensional garden, then the building will be kind of hidden inside. We didn't get the renders exactly to make it look like we wanted to make it look. But this was part, again, of the family. This was kind of a mutation of another competition. It was a Guggenheim Helsinki, which I think pretty much every architect in the world did, which, again, the notion was to carve and to almost hide the elements, and also there was a, the, I don't know, there was kind of a, a game to figure it out. What if from the outside it doesn't look so strange, but as you get closer, that you're confronted with this kind of a hyper-articulated interior. This animation is way slower than it should be. Oh, sorry. All right, I'll show you the next one. My bad. I think the last project of architecture, I have a couple of other things. It was a competition a couple of years, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago already. It was a competition for a museum in Budapest. And in this one, we were trying to also to create like parallel reality. So the construction of this movie was almost the desire of what we would like the building to be, like be alive and move. It's not what we submit. What we submit was like panels like everybody else. But we were much more interested in the development of the camera and to try to figure it out. Can we make these concrete eggs and then try to work with this very interesting skin, photovoltaic, solar panels of this company that they were developing. They're soft, they're almost like a fabric. And we thought that was an interesting notion to figure it out. Can we do that? Like, can we fix it and let it move and the wind will blow it? I mean, all ideas, of course, no jury in the right mind would ever consider. But again, they are platforms for ideas, for laboratories, and other things that come later out of it. I'm always obsessed with the notion of speculation. I don't like the word experimentation. I don't like the word radical or anything like that, because first of all, I think you experiment when you're trying to figure it out or you don't know exactly what you're doing, but we have an agenda, we have an alphabet, we have a repertoire, we have a style, if you will. I'm not afraid of the word style. And by now we all self-cannibalize each other. We reconnect, we assemble. It's more like a DJ game now, that we sample a lot of things about our own work, but also sometimes we throw other things into the game. And I think, I don't know, to me that is always, it's an interesting way, to navigate and to keep the curiosity, again, almost as a continuum, like you're always working on the same thing. So more recent stuff we've been working, and this is, believe it or not, before the pandemic, we were working in this mask for pollution. And the idea was that they will change color, it will have certain sensors, so it is very polluted the air, and it will be black, but then the air get better. It will have color. Again, it didn't happen at the time. This was a collaboration that we were trying to do with a company in Asia that they were interested in the notion of healthcare crossover with design and fashion. So they wanted to do all sorts of stuff that they would relate to healthcare and fashion. And we even talk about, and then we were joking, what is the sensor convey your mood? Which again, after we have a pandemic, wouldn't be an interesting thing that you can read if somebody's smiling under or somebody's angry, so somebody invite you to, come and talk to me or not. Other simple idea was, okay, we can do buttons, so you can take whatever jacket you have and just change the buttons, or zippers. Air plugs for some control. I suffer from tinnitus, so I have 24/7 in my ears. So when I'm in loud space, I do that, and they're kind of fine, but they're not cool. I always say, what if they became an accessory that you can, not that you're proud of whatever health issue you have, but also you don't have to hide it. Like, okay, this is what I do, and I can make it part of who I am, and so on. And this was like external patches for pacemakers or defibrillator, so you can show it. This was a little bit more, this was a colonoscopy bag vest, which I still think is interesting because people who have these illnesses, they have to deal with it. And some of them are interesting. Some of them are getting really interesting objects. But if these are something that we have to deal, it could be interesting to integrate it with them. We were looking one that it became like an oxygen vest, so people don't need to carry their tank. We went with more complex versions and we settled in a simpler one. These are something that I've been working for a while. The said ideas for hair issues. 3 or 4 years we've been working on it. But the idea is a simple one. The idea is the hair, the shoe will come with a lot of hair, and it will come with a pair of scissors, and it will give you different options how to stylize it for your own taste. Again, the notion with literal and animals and all this stuff. So anyway, the animation goes for a long time, but basically this is the principle. You open the box, you will find this, and then depends. I mean, you can cut it, you can comb it, you can have like a 60s. Okay, you're not such a good hair stylist, so we thought even if you screw it up, it still will be kind of interesting. Anyway, that was that. We also speculated one with, again, many of these companies are very interested in recycling and so on, but they always try to hide it. It became something else. So I said, okay, if we want to work in recycle, but can we make it look clearly that it was made out of recycle? So, because I think if you're a good citizen and so on, you want to be proud of it. It's like if you drive a Prius or a Tesla, you want people to know that you're taking care of it. So we thought that it could be interesting to make it more evident. This is a backpack that hug you and give you support. And the last thing I want to show you is the thing that we're working right now, ultra simple, rustic, primitive stuff. This is a table that we are working for the house I show you in Argentina. Again, a simple one, just a piece of wood, a bunch of legs. That's it. And then This is the one I'm really obsessed, and we're working on it right now. And okay, cheap wood wheels. We haven't figured out the structure of these things so it doesn't fall, so we're trying to figure out that. And then you take the foam that comes in trying to the mattresses, like a futon or whatever, and you fold them, and you with luggage strips or whatever, you just hold it. So we're doing the prototype for our home in LA, but the idea is that we want to do that. I mean, I don't know, it would be super cool to work with IKEA or somebody like that. It comes in a box, you put it together. So I think this is where we're going, like ultra primitive, simple, and so on. And again, it was fueled by this experience of doing this house in Argentina, and I went back, I don't know, 30 years to the beginning when I started designing, to go back and say, to look into things that are much simpler and they look to you and so on. So I'm not sure if we're going to go completely this direction or not, but this is where my mind is, and the mind of Rachel McCall, who worked with me in the office, and she's responsible for a big chunk of the latest work that I show you, and Nick Keeney and many other extraordinary people that have been working in the office over the years. That's it. Thank you. Do we have time for Q&As, Todd? Yeah. Now we can talk about whatever you want to talk. Or not. Yes. Yeah, you said it varies. When we're working with the cows, it was very straightforward. Like, we start literally with cows or carcasses and almost trace them in 3D and then start to manipulate them. And in the more recent work, like in the shoe, actually, shoes are incredibly typological, so they are what they are. So we were much more into attaching things. So again, we were looking hair, bubble gum, and we are very literal. Like, I'm still okay with the software, but I'm not that fast anymore. Now I'm working a lot on the iPad with the pen, so I literally am doing like DJing thing. Like, I will put the shoe, I will put hair, and I will grab bubbles, and just put it there, and I send it to Rachel. Rachel work his magic, send it back, and so on. But it's very right now, I would say it's very DJing. It's not different than sampling things. But one thing I noticed also, we are sampling ourselves a lot. Like we look and said, remember when we did the thing with the cows, why don't you take that piece? Well, we don't take that piece and we mix it with, I don't know, flowers or things like that. So I would say there was a time that there was more sampling. Now it's almost like there is a repertoire, if you wish. I mean, again, I don't think it's that different than making music. You know, like whatever, if you get an album of, I don't know, Beyonce or Tom Waits or whoever, there is a certain logic of their work that is present. So I'm not avoiding the question. I just said it has become in a lot second nature. It's like cooking. It's like, I mean, you know, like somebody was saying one time that it was an interesting comparison that, and this may be unfair for some of you who have expertise on it, but somebody was saying that pastry chef are like engineers and recipe and precision. Everything has to be exactly. And mostly chefs, they just improvise things. There isn't a structure or what they know what they want to do, but they keep adding it and changing it on the fly. Like if you go to a restaurant with a good chef and you order the same dish every day, it's not going to be exactly the same every day. I think there's a little bit more of that. I mean, I would say we are more in the chef side. I think some of my colleagues are more in the pastry, the very precise and so on. We are more messy. So we are very free and we flow. It's a lot of, let's say, jamming into it. So there is a method to the badness, I guess. But again, it has become so second nature. And I've been lucky enough that many of the people, the few people, because the office is almost all the time one, sometimes two people at a time, no more than that. I've been lucky that the people who work, they stay long. They hang around for a long time. I mean, Rachel now, Ivan Bernal, which is in Ken now before, Nick Kinney for a while, and other people over the years. They stick around for a while and they develop. We develop a way to work together that they have that kind of almost like a musical rhythm. So sorry, I cannot give you like, I would be lying to you if I give you like an ultra precise answer because I don't have it. Yeah. Well, in the sense that I'm not bound by, and this is especially with students in the audience, I want to be very careful with this because I don't think it's right. But the way my brain works, I don't think, for example, in materials or a structure or when I think about the designer is because I'm more driven by the fluidity of the things that we are working through the form and the mechanisms. So in that sense, I'm talking about a designer. Like I don't partition in my head or the people that we work together. We don't partition, we don't go to the steps of the logic of architecture. It's more about, and it's almost like reverse engineer. And then, okay, this, like there's no difference for me when I work in a shoe than, let's say we work in competition for a potential building. With the potential building, we reverse engineer a lot, and a lot of things we get in trouble. So that's what I'm saying. I want to be very careful because I don't think it's a good way to work if you're really committed to architecture. So I'm more committed to the idea of the design, which sometimes architecture is the vehicle for it, but not always. So it's a kind of a. I don't like to use autonomy neither because it's such a cliche, and in the culture of education in America implies certain alliances. That I try to be as much as I can as Groucho Marx. Like, I don't want to be a member of any club that has somebody like me as a member. So I always try to avoid those things. So that's what I mean by a designer. Like, to me, I work in the space of the computer or the iPad, and it's scaleless. There's not gravity, there's not other things and so on, which again, I don't recommend. I don't think it's a, well, one of the things also as you get older is whatever I said here is my version of it, it's my truth of what I think it is, but that doesn't mean that it's useful for anybody else. So each of you take whatever you want to take, but I think it's important to me for people, especially students, to understand that. And I think that has been, that has limitations. I think that has crippled the work that we do in the office to really maybe find a way to understand an architectural language out of that. Even I will say that in the house that we did in Argentina, I will credit most of the anchor into the possibility of architecture in Florencia, not me. I mean, she's the one who has that capacity. I really don't have it. And I think it has been a plus in certain things, and I think it's negative in other things. And also, I keep quoting Groucho Marx, I try to be very fluid about it. Like, if I give this lecture tomorrow, I may talk about something else. Like I said, I have the non Groucho Marx, these are my principles, and if you don't like it, I have these other ones, when it comes to design. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, because I was not thinking about how the hell we're going to be. First of all, I was not thinking that we would win it. So then we won it, and they give you at that time, but still it has been brutal all the way, but at that time was, again, I think this tie back to the conversation that's going on in SCI-Arc and the unfairness of all these things. Again, I accept my part of complicity, because that was a project that will give you 2 months, they will give you $70,000 to build it, and they knew that you all had to figure it out, that you will have raised money, you had to work with companies that will give you, they will donate you this and that. And myself and many others, we were complicit in that process. But going back to, I want to state that out, like knowing what I know now, I will not do that in those terms at all. But at that time when we did it, we also didn't think we would win, because we were in LA, the thing was in New York, what we thought we did was strange, so we worked on it, and then suddenly they told us, oh, you guys won, but you have 2 days to send us a prototype of one of the pieces to prove that you can build it. So I called a couple of people that I know that know way more than me. There was an engineer that wanted us to make columns like this, but my colleague Alexis Rocha says, no, we can do this with tubes and so on. And then we'll figure it out. And then it was one of the first time we used Rhino algorithms, because we came, I forgot the name, a person came with this strategy that we can do the draw, that we can do all this 2D, and then you can rotate it and create a 3D. So yeah, I was surprised that then we had to figure it out. And we learned some things along the way. Yeah, sorry. Yes.
So I know you used to work for and I actually watched some of your remarks you talk about it, and that was very interesting. So I was just curious if you could tell us more about your time working with him and like the techniques you
used. I was such a huge fan of his work. And again, I want to credit Carme Pinot, his first partner, too, and Benita Tagliabue, his second partner, because he also continued to do remarkable work, so Carme. So again, I tend to talk about more Enric because my friendship was with him, and because he's the link between those two different trajectories. But so I think it's important that he had partners that they did extraordinary work with him. But I was, and still I am, a huge fan of the work, and I literally, I put together my, no, not even that, I traveled with rolls of paper, I get in a plane, I went to Barcelona, got in a hostel, I went to a place called Miracle, this is what, you have to do everything by photocopy, so I had to make all these drawings into a portfolio, it took me like a week to put together a portfolio. When I knock on his office and says, I'm a huge fan of your work, I want to work for you. And he said, come back in 3 weeks. So I went somewhere else because I have family from Spain. My father was originally from Spain. And came back 3 weeks and started working. If you look carefully, not these things, but if you look, let me see. Hold on, let's do it faster. And I promised this to Jeff and Todd, and I never did, that I will give a lecture once. First, I will show every project that Enrique was looking while he was doing his work. But if you look at that plan, it has so much mirages in it. Like, if you look carefully, the genetic code is still there. The computer allowed me, but for example, when we went back to do this house in Argentina with simple materials and so on, the miragisms came back. The Carmé Pinot's thing came back. It's very much there. So what I learned from him was a bunch of stuff, many stuff. One of them, in a strange way, even though he was working analog by that time, his work was incredibly precise. He worked always with compass and triangles, and he almost never sketched freehand, which I don't do neither. I mostly work directly in the computer. And he was always obsessed with precision. And then, again, this is before computers, so he will take he always working in kind of 11 by 8.5 piece of balloon in pencil with two triangles and compass. He will give you these basic cool geometries, and then you will scale it up in the Xerox, and you will put in the side, and it will fit perfectly. So there was this notion of working also to understand that the tangent, that the curve made by the tangent two things with a compass is different than the one done with a French curve. Again, if you don't know what it is, Google it. This is before your time. So I learned that idea of the precision, the idea of a language of curvature and line, but also the most important thing was this notion of the everyday life that can be subliminized into something elevated. So he was looking into a jar of flowers, or he will come soap sculpted. And so the most important thing I learned from it was that, and the sense of humor in the work that he had, and the joy for it, and I don't know, the idea that architecture is a human endeavor, is a celebration of life, which I wish I was a little bit more joyful than he was. I am now, he died at 45, he died very young. And I always tell, I mean, when people ask me, you're gonna laugh, but the thing I keep, I mean, and I have every book that ever been published about their work, all of them, and I study every week, I will look at their work. I'm not saying that you should do that, but that's what I do. The thing I always remember the most, and it was super interesting, we were Saturday, it was only 4 or 5 in the office. We were working in competition, and I was a little kid in it. I mean, I was just one of the people doing that. I didn't have an important role in the office, I want to be very clear. And he showed up, dressed up super well, light a cigar, and Ricardo Flores, who at that time was him and Eva Pratt was his right hand, they asked him, hey, are you going to a party? Because there was a series of big events in Barcelona. He said, no. Today I'm going to do a beautiful drawing. And to me, that's it. That's what it is. It's the idea that when you sit to work, you have to find the joy in it, because I really believe that that's the first contribution. And he has this other thing which I always love, which is when you work in a problem, in a project, you have to leave the place better than what it was. It's a very simple thing, but it's, for me, it's profound. So every time that we work on something, we try to think about that. Now, I understand, I'm not an idiot, so I understand the work looks the way that it looks, but to me, everything that I show you is a more rational answer to the problem that was given to us. That's how I'm wired. So at some moment, you just have to embrace. So I learned that from him. Like, you can embrace it and figure it out and march on, and eventually it will produce something. But yeah, I mean, to me it was, I don't know, 8, 9, 10 months, whatever it was a trip. It was fantastic. I mean, I was, I don't know, 25. I was just coming out of school. And got to, I love it every second, but there were different times. Now things work differently, and people, I mean, there was still a little bit of that kind of atelier mentality, and he was a very generous person. So was Benedetta, his partner, to share with the people working what they were working on it, and he will talk about it. He liked to talk to himself when he was working. So if you were paying attention, you could see his process of thinking. It was very bizarre, but it was
it was pretty cool. One more, I think. We complete very few ones. So I find anything that they let us finish something, I find it super satisfactory. We don't have that many. I wish, you know, like this band. Again, this is VHS1 used to have one hit wonder. I wish we were a one hit wonder, like at least we did one. I find all of them satisfying. I also, to be honest, I'm very peculiar in that sense because, again, I'm 53. I'm not a kid. I'm not somebody upcoming. I don't get frustrated when things don't happen because I still find joy in the process of doing it. Everything I show you today, none of them is made up things. So it was a competition. Somebody asked us a product, this, somebody. In that sense, I'm a very conventional person. We only work when people ask us to work. I don't do research. I don't create things out of nothing or anything, which I think is something that all of you, I have the feeling that many of you are gonna develop practices and form of things that we don't know yet that exist. In that sense, I'm very conventional. So, right now I tell you, I'm super excited about it doesn't get simpler than this. And I'm super excited about it. And I cannot explain why, because it's all, I'm one of those people that I don't feel envy. I feel like architecture is a collective thing, so that's why what's going on right now in SCI-Arc is heartening to me, because I love architecture and I understand architecture as a collective thing. So I think when we fail as an institution or when we fail as leaders, I feel that we all suffer from that, and I take that burden seriously. But in that collective thing, I always look with people who have that capacity to think simple, and you say, that's great, I wish I can think something. And this is the first time, the table is okay. I don't like it that much. I think it's okay. But this one, I'm super excited. And it's the first time I've done something that I think is simple, that I feel excited about it. So it's a new territory. It's a new beginning in a way. So I don't know where it will take us. Maybe it's a one of a kind. Sorry, that was a long answer to a simple question, but yeah, whatever we can get done is cool. We can talk later.